We've had decades or, you know, maybe 10 or 20 years of active managers underperforming passive managers. Mm-hmm. Money is poured into passive funds at the expense of active funds. The amount of coverage of companies on Wall Street has decreased. All these trends have kind of ignored the fundamentals behind companies, quantitative trading too. I think there's a great opportunity now. You know, I've only known one way of investing for 35, 40 years, and that is good old-fashioned stock picking. Roll up your sleeves, read 10Ks and 10Qs, understand industries, talk to company managements, and you know, find good companies selling at reasonable valuations with great management teams. That's what we're going to be doing.
So just explain this, though. Why now? I mean, what was it about now? I assume you've been thinking about this for some time.
You know,
was there a lunch, a meeting, a conversation or something?
No, I wouldn't necessarily say that. This took me all of about a month, but you know, even when I got out of the market in 2013, I've still been very active and involved with my own account. I've still been investing for the 5 or 6 years. I especially got active in 2018. I mean, it might sound crazy, but during earnings season, I look up the earnings and the results and the conditions every single company that reports earnings. I still do that, and I'm not in business. So I said to myself, of course, you know, I love doing this. I miss doing this. You know, let's go from the minor leagues, which is running my own account, to the big leagues again, institutional money, and have fun at it. So I think the time's perfect.
Now, you mentioned this whole idea of quantitative trading, the move to passive. A lot of people look at this and they say, well, the collective psychology of the market has changed, that because there are fewer fundamental stock pickers out there like yourself, that the price discovery dynamics have completely changed in the markets. Do you see that reversing
Absolutely
and going
not.
Back to?
That's nonsense. And you know what? When all the stocks in the market go up because of program trading or algorithmic trading go down, et cetera, that's at the end of the day, if you look at companies, in my opinion, they're driven by their earnings prospects. So whether or not they're volatile or whether they go down too much because a sell program hit, you know, that's an opportunity to buy them. At the end of the day, a year from now, 5 years from now, companies will sell at valuation based on that company's fundamentals. That has always been the case, and in my opinion, it's always going to be the case. And this volatility that we have is the word of the day, for me at least, opportunity.
Well, that's what I was going to say. I mean, I look back at the last 10 years, and I think about this wave of money and liquidity that kind of washed over. We talked with people like David Tepper about that. We talked with investors like Warren Buffett and Bill Gates about the idea that when interest rates are so low, there's basically nowhere else to put your money, which is why stocks have been riding high. You think we're coming to an end of that period and you're going to start to see volatility and start to see differences in how things trade? Because I would say it's been a difficult time to find opportunities, places where a single stock outperforms when you've got kind of the tide lifting all boats.
You know, look at the S&P performance in 2018. I can't cite the names, but I guarantee you there were a dozen stocks up over 100%, a dozen stocks down over 50%. It wasn't program trading that caused it. It's because of that company's fundamentals. Mm-hmm. So I don't believe that
at all.
It does.
I mean, I feel like you're going to have a lot more opportunities going forward, I guess, is my expectation.
There are plenty of opportunities today. That's what I'm looking at. You know, in terms of different asset classes doing well, my belief is that we're, you know, in a secular bull market. In retrospect, I didn't know it at the time. It started in 2009. And if I had to guess, we're halfway through it, driven by good economic growth and low inflation.
You think we're halfway through it?
Secular. 10 years in, 10 years to go. I don't know. Yeah. That's my guess.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a lot of people would say you start a fund right now.
Yeah.
If this is the eighth or ninth inning, tough time to do it.
First of all, with good stock picking, it can work in secular bull markets, secular bear markets. So that's number one. In fact, secular bear markets, the volatility can be a good thing for opportunities. Mm-hmm. Second of all, if we're half secular bull market, we're 9 years, you know, secular bull market, it started in 2019. There was a correction in 15, 16. There's a correction now. My guess is, driven by good economy and low inflation, we're going to go another 10 years here, plus or minus. We will have cyclical bear markets in between. I don't know what's going to happen the next 6 months, but long term, I'm very optimistic.
So now, I think your timing is really, really interesting here, as I mentioned in the hit. Last year's biggest fundraise among the biggest fundraises was Steve Cohen reentering the market and opening his fund .72 up to outside investors again. The market that he reentered provided one where he posted only 0.5% returns for the year. Now, I know you're not allowed to comment on the fundraise, but yours is shaping up to be among the largest of 2019. So how do you differentiate yourself from the other hedge fund managers in the market that have failed to really produce the returns that they saw decades ago?
You know, so I put blinders on, and I've always operated that way. I don't really pay attention to what, in fact, when I talk to other hedge fund managers, sometimes they sound so smart they screw up my head. I like to stick to our knitting. What I'm seeing is plenty of opportunities in the market. And the other thing is that this is very similar to, I believe, when we went originally in business from 1996 to 2000. We were a small shop. I was actively involved. I am going to be the one. I'm the analyst, you know, the main analyst, as well as the portfolio manager. I'm going to spend my days calling companies, analyzing industries, picking good stocks. And I absolutely believe with that kind of effort and that kind of commitment, and I think you guys said it in a press release, the fire in my belly still burns. I am ready to go, and I just think it's a fun time to be in.
And not for the Jeff Vinik family trust either. That's interesting.
My family foundation is a major motivator here, and you know what?
But why not just do that? Why go back into OPM?
Because as I said earlier, I want to be in the. It's just when you have a higher profile and you have institutional money, it's going to push me that much harder, number one. Number two, to be blunt, I can make more money from my family foundation that my wife and I can give away over the years if we do it via.
I think a lot of people are like you. I don't expect, like, Druckenmiller to come back in. I know he thinks very highly of you. He thinks you're a great money manager, but I don't see him coming back.
You know, I was having a conversation with him about a month ago. And I just enjoyed it so much and missed it so much. You talk about what happened. Maybe Sparks it was that conversation with might Stan. Have
been, yeah. Do you think the size, though, in terms of fund size, is helpful or is the enemy of success?
You know, I've said from day one that size and performance are inversely related. So there's no doubt as you get bigger, it gets a little bit harder to outperform. But markets are big. There is plenty of liquidity as far as I'm concerned. The market is, cap is three times what it was, five times as much as it was when I started 20 years ago. So I don't see that as a constraint. I believe I can put up good numbers even with, you know, with the size of the assets.
Any investments right now you just love?
No, I will not. I don't want to talk about individual investments, but you know, honestly, I think technology is in the middle of a 20-year run, just like the market is. I think construction materials look interesting. I think there are a bunch of things.
Okay. What about the business model for hedge funds? Obviously, that alone has changed in the last 6 years. We're seeing the larger hedge funds get larger, more diversified, getting into multiple strategies. Fees, of course, have come down. Are any of those things concerning to you as you embark on relaunching your hedge fund in this new environment?
No, they're not. And again, it's a little bit of back to the future, whatever you want to call it. You know, going back to 1996, we are going to be, you know, this is me running investors' money and trying to do as well as I can and being extremely focused on that. This is not about clipping coupons and management fees. This is about growing people's monies long term. This is like the 90s. I love this. I love being active in the market. I'm doing this to show what I can do.
And hockey and baseball doesn't do it for you?
Well, I don't own the Red Sox anymore, so.
Not even minority.
I'm not a minority. No, I sold it about a year ago.
Oh, good timing.
We'll see. I missed my fourth.
But Tampa Bay's in first place, right?
The Lightning are doing great, and I love the Lightning. But if you look what I have going on in Tampa Bay, the Lightning and our real estate company that I've pushed again and again and again, everybody should move to Tampa. If you look at all the things that I'm involved with down there, I've got great leadership on each one. Now is a perfect time to let that leadership do their thing like I like to do. I'm focusing on this new portfolio.